Sertogenbos, a Dutch town, capital of the province of North Brabant, a fortress town with a history of 800 years. Ramparts, moats, historic buildings. St. John's Cathedral rises high and dominating. To the people of the surrounding villages, it is the big city. But in the dark autumn of 1944, Sertogenbos, witness of many battles, sieges, and bloodshed in the past, found itself once more shattered by a violent war. What happened to Sertogenbos happened to many towns and villages in the Netherlands. Here, the liberation of 1944 did not come suddenly. There was no invasion or spectacular airborne operation. Liberation came slowly, after weeks of tense waiting, and not until after a violent battle had raged over the city. A German and a British division fought for 6 days for the possession of Sertogenbos. For them, it was just another important strategic objective. But for the people of Den Bosch, it meant the end of 4 years of Nazi oppression. For them, these 6 days also brought the most fearful hours of the entire war. It all began at the end of September 1944. The Battle of Arnhem is lost. The corridor, which that operation hoped to create across the three major rivers in the Netherlands, ends in a blind alley across the Vaal River near Nijmegen. The front has stabilized. Both sides recuperate from the recent battle. In the last week of September, a German infantry division is sent to Sertogenbos to seal off a sector of the front on the western half of the corridor. The division has fought hard in Belgium and the southwest of Holland. Since the beginning of August, it suffered heavy losses, and time after time has had to retreat. The 712th Infantry Division is a division of battle-weary and defeated soldiers. Commander is 57-year-old General Lieutenant Friedrich Neumann. In the first days of October, Neumann and his staff are billeted in a small suburb of Sertogenbos, the Hinthammer Park.
Hiernaast woonde de familie Kloppenburg, Kampfoeliestraat 1, en daar kwam generaal Neumann zijn intrek nemen met zijn chauffeur en zijn oppasser. En wij kregen hier 3 officieren met een aantal soldaten. De officieren waren toevoegende staf van de generaal Neumann. En soldaten die hadden hier een veldpostkantoor. Zodoende stond de hele dag die voordeur open. He, dus in- en uitlopen en drukte van je welste. Ik moet zeggen dat wij niet veel last ondervonden hebben. Geen nadigheden ondervonden hebben van de Duitsers. En achteraf hebben wij beseft dat het erg moeilijk is als je van mens tot mens met elkaar in aanraking komt, om je dan als een vijand te beschouwen.
The training unit to which then 18-year-old Heinrich Schlaghagen belonged had seen action before in Belgium.
Er litten dort nach mehrmaligen schweren Zusammenstößen erhebliche Verluste, sodass unsere Einheit fast vollkommen aufgerieben wurde. Reste und Versprengte unserer Einheit wurden den benachbarten Kampftruppen zugeteilt und im weiteren Verlauf unserer Absetzbewegungen kamen wir über die holländische Grenze, über Tilburg und Eindhoven Richtung Herzogenbusch. Hier wohnen wir in einem Schwesternwohnheim namens der Marienburg einquartiert und blieben dort für 14 Tage untergebracht. Während dieser Zeit, als die Front immer näher auf uns zukam, waren wir noch zum Stellungsbau an der Peripherie der Stadt Herzogenbusch eingesetzt.
The Dutch are ordered to assist in the digging. Men are picked up from the streets at will and put to work on the defenses. Meanwhile, British artillery firing from the corridor harasses German-held territory. On September 28th, the first shells hit Sertogenbos. people go in search of better shelter. Many find refuge in the flour mill.
Wij hadden juist in 1940 een sterke betonnen constructie laten maken, waaronder een prachtige betonnen kelder. Dus wij zochten met de employés, drie gezinnen, zochten wij een onderkomen in die kelder 's nachts. Dat werd nagelang dus oktober voortschreed steeds meer, want die oorlogshandelingen, je hoorde steeds meer het geschut dichterbij komen. En iedere dag kwamen er nieuwe mensen in die kelder met bedden en weet ik het allemaal. Op plaats zaten we daar met een 150 man. Het was niet altijd doffe ellende, want we hebben er ook veel gelachen. Er waren mensen, gingen vroeg naar bed en die sliepen dan. Anderen die waren wakker. We hadden er één bij die droomde iedere nacht. Dat was onze zakkenteller. En die zat zakken te tellen. 1, 2, 3, 4. Dan was hij de tel kwijt. En begon hij weer opnieuw. Dus hilariteit in die kelder. Tot dan was het toch altijd, de mensen vonden elkaar. Dus het was een prettige aangelegenheid.
Had ik reeds een geheime zender. Dat was de zender Oeteldonk in 's-Hertogenbosch. Hier meedraaide en ik grammofoonplaatjes op verzoek op de 300 meter band. En deze zender werd na een lange tijd draaien, werd hij in beslag genomen door de radiocontroledienst, waarbij de heer Van Schendel en een regisseur van politie mij opkwamen halen en deze zender dus in beslag hebben genomen. Er ging een hele tijd overheen. Ik heb inmiddels examen gedaan voor zendamateur en ik stond dus geregistreerd als zendamateur. En in de oorlog mocht dat natuurlijk niet. En op een gegeven moment in 1942, toen stond diezelfde meneer Van Schendel voor de deur. En ik vond dat raar. En na een beetje omdraaien en alle mogelijke verhaaltjes die hij vertelde, kwam het er dan uit dat hij vroeg of dat ik radiotelegrafist wilde worden voor het verzet. Ik ben toen in de OD gekomen. Karel Thomas, die was mijn commandant. Dat is allemaal prima gegaan. Wij hebben toen professionele zenders gekregen van Philips. Die werden clandestien gemaakt bij Philips in Eindhoven. En ik zat hier in de Kalverstraat in de voorkamer. Daar had ik mijn werkplaatje als radioman. Ik werkte ook onder andere voor de Duitsers aan de overkant van de Luftwaffe. En ik had hier mijn antenne gespannen. En dat liep allemaal gesmeerd. Niemand heeft er ooit erg in gehad, zelfs de buren niet. En ik heb dus rustig in die tijd mijn geheime boodschappen kunnen versturen.
Everyone is expecting the British to begin their attack on 's-Hertogenbosch any moment. But the days drag on without anything happening. The truth is that the Allied commanders are still discussing what strategy to adopt next. For since the beginning of September, the Allied armies suffer from a real crisis in supply. Petrol, ammunition, rations, everything still has to be transported all the way from the Normandy beaches, now more than 300 miles away. The Allied supply lines have grown far too long. No advance into Germany can be contemplated until a major port closer to the armies can be found. The irony is that the Allies are already holding such a port, Antwerp. But they cannot use it because the Scheldt estuary, the entrance to Antwerp, is still firmly in German hands. Therefore, freeing Antwerp is first priority. The blockade must be lifted. On October 16th, British Field Marshal Montgomery issues his directive M352. His army commanders are to use the whole of their available offensive power to free the port of Antwerp. Canadian First Army is to capture the Scheldt estuary itself, while British Second Army will launch itself from the corridor to the west in order to cut the German lines of communication south of the River Maas. 's-Hertogenbosch is the pivotal point of the German positions south of the Maas. Once this town is taken, the road to the west will be open. Therefore, General Dempsey, commander of the Second Army, decides that one division of his 12th Corps will concentrate on the capture of Denbosch only. This task is given to the 53rd Welch Division. The 53rd Division is truly a Welch unit. Six out of its 9 infantry battalions come from famous regiments of Wales. Commander is Major General Bobby Ross. The divisional plan for the capture of 's-Hertogenbosch, Operation Allen, is a masterpiece of simplicity. The attack will be launched from the direction of Oss in the northeast, with two brigades up, 160 Brigade north of the Oss-'s-Hertogenbosch road, and 71st Brigade south of it. The 3rd Brigade, 158, is in reserve. But one of its battalions will stand ready to exploit a possible breakthrough with an armored column and try to reach the city itself. So if everything goes according to plan, then the battle will be decided on the very first day. The Welsh Division has based its plan on all the information available. Spy reports on German positions in the Sertogenbosch area are smuggled through the lines by Dutch underground. RAF reconnaissance planes make hundreds of aerial photographs of the area. These and other sources build up to a complete picture of the other side of the hill. But as much as the British know of the enemy, so little do they know of the Dutch resistance in Sertogenbosch. In the planning of Operation Allen, Dutch underground is simply not reckoned with. But the resistance groups, aware of the coming military operation, have indeed made their own plans. The plan that is to have the farthest reaching consequences is made by a group from the organization called RVV. Chief of this little group is Karel van der Donk.
Na Arnhem kwam van het geallieerde hoofdkwartier de instructie aan de verzetsorganisaties alle activiteiten in dienst te stellen van de geallieerde operaties, hetgeen onder meer inhield het bewaken van vitale objecten. In verband hiermee werd overleg gepleegd met de OD en afgesproken dat de RVV-ploeg zich in zou zetten voor het behoud van de grote verkeersberoofde Diezen. Kort nadien werd de groep versterkt door drie Russen, Arthur, André en Nicolai, die via de illegale organisatie in S en in Den Bosch uiteindelijk door werden gespeeld naar de Raad van Verzet. Ze waren gekleed in Duitse uniformen en waren bewapend.
The Dieser Bridge plan of the resistance group is simple. They will establish three posts around the bridge, two in the south bank and one in the north. The post on the north bank is in a house several hundred yards away from the bridge. The team there, three Dutchmen and two of the Russians, has the prime task. When the British offensive has started and the Germans are likely to blow the bridge, they are to dress up in German uniforms, attack the guards at the bridge, disconnect the fuses in the northern pier, and hold the bridge until the Tommies arrive. The two posts on the south bank have a supporting role. These teams find hiding places close to the bridge. One is in a house immediately next to the ramp. The other is in an upstairs room of a hotel at the far end of the ramp. From early October onwards, all three posts are manned permanently.
Ja, hier was onze post 3. En hier zat ik met de Limburgse jongen, Kretje Mijn, enkele weken bij de brug te wachten op de dingen die zouden komen. Onze bewapening die bestond uit een Duitse mitrailleur en een FN 9 mm pistool en wat Duitse steelhandgranaten. Het was ook in deze tijd dat onze commandant Karel van der Donk ziek werd. Zodat ik dus hem regelmatig informeerde en ik ook de nodige informatie van hem kon krijgen.
We zaten hier dus binnen en op boven. En wij, ja, wat moesten we overdag doen? We hadden wel een radio en die werd ook wel eens op de Russische zender afgesteld. En dan hoorden we de klokken van het Kremlin en dan was Arthur in de zevende hemel. Maar overdag deden we ook iets. We oefenden met onze geweren. Want uiteindelijk, ik had ook nog nooit een Duitse karabijn in mijn handen gehad. En we deden gemoefeningen en we aanslagoefeningen. We hadden een Duits-Nederlands boekje. Hè? En daar zaten we dus ook woordjes uit te grabbelen. En zo hebben we onze tijd proberen te doden.
In the early hours of October 22nd, the assault battalions of the 53rd Welsh Division move up to the start line between the villages of Geffen and Winkel. 160 Brigade, north of the Ostendbosch Road, has as its first objective the village of Nuland. For this attack, the brigade has been given a horrible weapon, flame-throwing tanks.
40 years ago, I was a troop leader in the 141st Regiment Royal Armoured Corps. We weren't part of the 53rd Welsh Division, but we were attached to them for this battle, and this was the first day of the battle. Now, my troop consisted of four flame-throwing tanks called Crocodiles. They were 40-ton Churchill tanks. They had a big trailer behind them in which we had 400 gallons of what would now be called napalm. And this was projected from the front of the tank for about 100 meters by high-pressure gas. And before each action, we had to prepare the trailer, open up the gas bottles, and make quite complicated preparations. We came to this point here in order to do the attack on the church over there and the position surrounding it. And the Germans had a number of anti-tank guns. There was one we knew to the left of the church, and there were some others suspected. And our objective, finally, was the church. That was our landmark, that church tower up there above the trees.
We crossed the start line near Geffen at 6:30 in the morning, and for the first 150 yards had no opposition. Then the Germans saw us, and down came the shells and machine gun fire. The tanks supporting us from the left were bogged down and suffered from mines, but they managed to keep up with us, and we went in straight away with fixed bayonets and grenades.
In the village of Newland, fierce house-to-house fighting develops. The German 712th Fusilier Battalion stubbornly resists the Welsh infantry. Meanwhile, Lieutenant Wilson and his crocodile has reached his objective, the village church.
And it was then that I came onto the front of the objective again, where there had been a 37 millimeter anti-tank gun. Now, as we attacked this, we had flamed that gun as we supported the 4th Welsh to come in. And the gun itself had been overrun by one of the tanks, and the wheel was collapsed, and everything around had been burned by the flame. And there was there, in particular, I remember one German, and he had been, had everything burned off him except his helmet and his boots. And this was a figure of a man totally blackened, and it was one of the most horrible things, I think, that I saw in the war, an absolutely obscene object. And there were other Germans there who had been very badly wounded, either by artillery or by the flame. And it was one of the most striking occasions on which I saw the results of using the flamethrower. If you were an artilleryman, you seldom saw the results of what you did, but with the flame, on occasions like this, we had an immediate confrontation with the results.
By 11 o'clock in the morning, Newland is finally cleared of Germans. Meanwhile, on the right flank of 160 Brigade, the 2nd Monmouthshires have fought themselves past Newland and are slowly advancing towards Rosmarlen.
We fought our way up the dike with one platoon on the right and one platoon on the left and made rapid progress. One of my platoon commanders, Sergeant Niblett, was held up by a Spandau, and he immediately picked up the Bren and charged it, killing the three occupants. And it was this sort of action which kept the speed of the advance going. We reached the crossroads at Quistrat by midday and were ordered to dig in because an armored column was then going to be passed through with the objective of Sertogenbosch itself.
The reports of reaching Krausstraat sound very promising, and General Ross sees an opportunity for the planned swift advance of the armored column straight through to Sertogenbosch. The 1st Battalion East Lancashires is sent on its way in kangaroos, tanks without turrets and capable of carrying 10 soldiers. But the plan goes adrift from the start. The East Lancs do not receive the arranged code signal until 2 in the afternoon, and this late warning leaves them with just a few hours of daylight to complete their mission. Furthermore, the column is much too long. No less than 111 vehicles are to drive along a narrow, winding country track. What should have been a lightning advance develops into a huge traffic jam. To make matters worse, the Germans have built a second line of defense in Krausstraat. The 53rd Recce Regiment in the lead is held up, and when tanks go forward, two of them are hit by a mine. Flails, mine-clearing tanks, are called forward to open a path through the minefield. The East Lancs and their kangaroos are ordered to debus. They're to take Krausstraat as ordinary foot soldiers. By then, the effort to reach Den Bosch has failed. The British are still 5 miles short of the objective.
En 's middags, uur of 4, toen kregen wij onze eerste granaten op het Hintonpark. De Duitsers waren intussen naar de bunker vertrokken, waarschijnlijk zaten ze al, want die hebben natuurlijk wel aanvoelen komen dat het menens ging worden. En toen wij aanmerking maakten over dat schieten, toen zeiden de soldaten, ja, dat is nu een der krieg.
Now that the original plan has failed, the Welsh Division has no alternative than to continue the attack with the same two brigades until a new plan has been made. 71st Brigade advances slowly through heavily wooded country. Their opponents, German 732 Grenadier Regiment, fights to the end. 160 Brigade takes all day to advance the 2 miles from Krausstraat to Rossmalen. Again, the flamethrowers are called forward.
They put in an attack with the flamethrower, and a lot of German casualties occurred. We had 19 Germans who actually died of their flame wounds in the first aid posts. And at that point, the Germans put in a counterattack.
The German command in Holland, alarmed by the serious losses of the 712th Division on the first day, sends all of the reinforcements it can spare to the Zertogenbosch front. On the second day, a self-propelled gun company reaches the divisional headquarters at Hintum. General Neumann orders them to counterattack Rossmalen without delay. He knows that this is his last opportunity to check the enemy offensive.
I was listening to this from the distance where I was behind. I heard the shots coming, I heard the confused sounds over the radio, and often what the first thing that you knew on the wireless net that a tank had been hit was that suddenly that particular tank was no longer answering its call sign. And it was my Sergeant Warner, whom I'd lent to number 12 troop. There was an SP over there. It had caught him in a classic ambush position from behind as part of the counterattack. The shot had gone through the turret, it had killed Warner, it had killed his operator, and the whole column of tanks was halted here by the SPs, and the tanks then finally had to withdraw. It was impossible at that point even to get into Warner's tank to get out the bodies.
The tank battles around Rossmalen last all afternoon. Several self-propelled guns are knocked out, and the rest can only just escape to Hintum. The Germans have lost their last chance to stem the tide before the gates of the city. By the end of the second day, Rossmalen is free. A new phase in the battle is about to begin. The Welsh Division has a new plan ready, which is to start that same night. First, the German main force, retreating along the Ostend-Bosch Road, is to be surrounded. The 6th Royal Welsh Fusiliers will attack Hintum and cut the main road behind the Germans. Then, next morning, the 7th Royal Welsh Fusiliers will attack along this same road and put the Germans in the bag. Meanwhile, an attack on Zertogenbosch itself is to be made along the railway line. 2 battalions, the 1st East Blanks and the 1st 5th Welsh, are to make a surprise night march along the railway embankment and enter the city, as it were, through the back door. The attack on Hintum starts without the commanders having had time to reconnoiter the area.
I was on the right-hand side of the road, and on the left I heard one of my platoons firing. I went to see what had happened. They had come up against quite a large ditch, not shown, unfortunately, on this photograph, which is the one I worked from, but shown, alas, quite clearly on some others. I went to see what happened. It was a deep ditch. It was up to my neck, probably, if I got right into it. And it was full of wire. It was, in fact, I think, cattle wire, not proper defensive wire. The Germans and the farm were alert. Every time you moved on the left-hand side here, they tossed grenades out of the windows. Fortunately, they couldn't toss them far enough to get in the ditch. And we let them have it as hard as we could, and we thought we'd try and rush, but we weren't doing any good. The moment we moved, we got a burst of spandau and a number of casualties. By then, we could hear an enormous row going on in the other end of the village, which, of course, was Marsh and A Company.
Major Marsh and his company have indeed fought their way into Hintum, but they've run into trouble. The small force is flooded by German troops retreating through the village, and the Welshmen are forced to retreat into houses around the village church. They are virtually cut off, and all they can do is hold on and wait for relief.
Om 11:30 s'nachts is toen werkelijk de hel losgebarsten. En dat heeft geduurd tot 4 uur. Dat is niet te beschrijven, dat is verschrikkelijk geweest. Kleine kinderen, er waren een kind van 1 en van 2 van 3 jaar zaten er. Mevrouw Kloppenburg was in verwachting. Wat wij als kinderen eigenlijk allemaal niet beseft hebben, hoe erg dat voor de ouders geweest moet zijn. En 11:30 brak er brand uit. En toen wisten we helemaal niet meer waar we toe waren. En tot 4 uur ongeveer zijn we in de kelder met boven onze brandend huis gebleven. En toen moesten we eruit. Terwijl nog steeds die granatenregen doorging. We hadden 3 uitgangen oorspronkelijk gehad, er was nog maar 1 van overgebleven. We hadden toen, zoals iedereen waarschijnlijk, een hoop klaarstaan. Ieder voor zich een kussensloop met allerhande spullen, kleren en zo. Hebben we geen kans te zien op dat te nemen, want we waren o zo bang dat opnieuw de beschieting zou beginnen. Dus wij zijn naar de bunker van generaal Neumann gevlucht. En die zat vol. We mochten er gelukkig in. Over ons hoofd heen werden orders doorgegeven. Of nieuws aan de generaal. En op een gegeven moment, het zal rond 5:30 zijn geweest, toen werd de beraadslaagd door de generaal met zijn staf om op te stappen. Wij kregen de indruk dat hij niet graag wilde gaan. Maar op aandringen van zijn officieren is het wel gebeurd. En toen hadden wij de bunker voor ons alleen.
While the battle in Hintem rages on, the second part of the British plan begins. The night assault along the railway.
I was commanding B Company of the 1st 5th Battalion, the Welsh Regiment, part of the assault force for the capture of the city of Sertogenbosch. The leading troops were the 1st Battalion, the East Lancs, with ourselves behind, with our D Company leading and my company behind. Now, the going was very tough because the ground was very swampy, intersected with small streams, very low lying. We couldn't get our transport up with us, and so we had to go the whole way on foot with some assistance from artificial moonlight, which is the use of searchlights reflecting light from their beams onto low cloud above. Now, we didn't really meet very much resistance because obviously the East Lancs and D Company in front bore the brunt of that. But the artillery fire was going on overhead all the time. A weak German retaliatory fire, not very much. And we really saw very little of them except for captured prisoners coming back until we got to the outskirts of Sertogenbosch itself.
But getting transport and heavy weapons into town is quite another matter. John Johnson, then in the East Lancs anti-tank platoon, remembers the difficulties of the night.
Originally, it was planned to set off the attack by the AFVs carrying bundles of brushwood, which we would place in the ditches so that the carriers and the Cardinal Lloyds and the anti-tank guns could get over these ditches. But finding this was when we tried it out, it was found to be difficult, and it was also found to be impracticable. So what they did in the end is to go up the embankment and get onto the railway lines with the anti-tank guns and carriers, and we started to go along the track, bumping and the guns bouncing up and down. The driver was driving the Cardinal Lloyds, and the men, gun crews, were walking alongside. This necessitated sometimes that we were going to have to get the gun, manhandle it over certain obstacles, such as when we came to crossings, and that way we went straight up to where the infantry positions were.
The night assault is a decisive success. The Welshmen have achieved complete surprise, and the Germans do not in the least suspect that 2 enemy battalions are about to enter the town. The Dutch, in their cellars, are equally unaware. At the Dieser Bridge, the RVV resistance men are puzzled. They realize that their hour of action is near, but they do not know that the Welsh soldiers are already in the town and approaching fast.
wij dachten, nou gaat het gebeuren. Dus wij trokken onze Duitse uniformen aan en wij zouden paraat moeten zijn om eventueel naar de Diezenbrug te kunnen gaan. Maar ja, het was zo'n geweldig vuur dat wij dus in de gang bleven staan wachten en we zagen ook nog regelmatig Duitsers langs ons huis komen. Op een zeker moment komt Jan achter binnen en hij zegt, jongens, de Tommies zijn hier al. Ja, wat nou? Wij hadden Duitse uniformen en als we nou naar buiten zouden gaan, ja, was dat natuurlijk levensgevaarlijk, want die Engelsen konden aan ons niet zien dat we geen echte Duitsers waren, want we hadden uiteindelijk een heel Duits uitrusting. Dus wij ons plunje uitgetrokken, ons uniform, en ons eigen plunje aangetrokken.
But the advancing Welsh troops do not expect the presence of Dutch and even less of Russian underground workers. Bill Owen, then intelligence officer of the 1st 5th Welsh, remembers the confusion.
Shortly after we arrived, I was approached by a man who to this day I believe to have been a Russian. I was very surprised at this. He was dressed in very ragged clothes and he appeared to be indicating to me by gestures and words such as boom, boom, that the bridge had been prepared for demolition. I regarded him with acute suspicion, and in normal circumstances, I would have had him arrested and sent to the rear. In the event, I ignored what he had to say.
The Dutch see their carefully prepared scheme rapidly slipping out of their hands. They expect the bridge to go up any minute, but things move fast.
And although it had not been in the original plan for Captain Morgan to attempt to cross the bridge, on the spur of the moment, Colonel Nelson Smith decided to order Captain Morgan to proceed to the bridge and get over it.
It was now beginning to get light, and I had firm orders to go for the bridge. So we set off down the road, almost running in our haste to get there, but running into Germans on the way as well, many of them in the rear areas doing things like maintenance of their vehicles. We had a few running battles, shot quite a few, and then we ran into a complete German field ambulance on its way towards our rear areas to surrender. I couldn't be bothered with it because I wanted to get to the bridge quickly. So I left it there, pushed on, but unfortunately quite near the bridge, a leading platoon again took a wrong turning and turned left instead of going straight on at a road junction. So I chased after it, got it straight, turned round, but that then brought us to the left of the bridge. But by turning right and running along the river bank, we got our first view of the bridge.
Heel de nacht werd er geschoten. Toen tegen de morgen om 7:00 werd het rustig. En ging mijn vriend Leo van den Ende, die ging even boven Pools hoogte nemen. Hij mocht dat, omdat hij employé van de fabriek was. En hij zag verdraaid een aantal gestalten over de brug rennen met geweren. Goed kijken. Ja, het waren Tommies. Gauw naar boven, naar de eerste verdieping. Nog meer Tommies. Die gingen door. Andere klommen op de pijlers van de brug. Gooiden dingen in het water. Munitie, ik weet het niet. Andere kisten werden doorgegeven naar boven. Die werden op de brug gezet. En hij gauw naar beneden. Jongens, de Tommies zijn er. Nou is het gauw afgelopen.
When I finally reached the bridge, it was getting light. We were beginning to see things. And I saw straight away the 10 platoon were here with Jack Griffin, the company second in command. And they had got clear of the bridge and were digging in on a small traffic roundabout that was just at the far end of the bridge. It was grassed and they were attempting to dig themselves in, but there was some rather heavy fire coming down from the Germans. Now, at this point, we were very glad to see two Dutch resistance people coming around with a gun to help us. They wore orange armbands and we thought, this is good, excellent, this is going to do the trick.
En de Engelsen die namen onze mitrailleur over, de Duitse mitrailleur over. En daar vertrokken ze mee naar richting Brugplein. En dan gingen ze in stelling. Er werd hier achter in het huis de 18Z, een radioontvanger, werd er binnengezet. Een ambulancevlag werd er aan het huis bevestigd.
But now, unfortunately, as time was getting on, after being here about
an hour, there were signs of the Germans preparing for a strong assault on the position and using tanks. Now, that was a bit of a shock to us, because an intelligence summary beforehand said there were no tanks in the area at all, and we only had what is called a Piat, which is an infantry handheld anti-tank weapon. We only had two of those. One had got lost on the way around to the bridge. And so I looked around for the one that we had left, and to my horror, I saw it lying on the bridge. It had been left there as we crossed it and was in full view of the Germans and under fire. We couldn't get at it.
The enemy tanks are those that escaped from the battle at Rossmalen the day before. Their rapid arrival here is due to Oberst de Wald, the commander of Sertogenbosch, who, after getting the first reports of enemy troops in the town on his own initiative, decides to send all the guns at his disposal to the Dieser Bridge.
En de Engelsen die zongen de moed in de schoenen toen ze die monsters aan zagen komen. En een Engelsman die zette zijn geweer tegen de trap aan en die had het helemaal gezien. Hij zegt, nou, het is voor mij gedaan.
The tanks came down the road. One in particular came right down to the house I'm outside now. And I was in the window upstairs. I could almost have reached out of the window and touched the turret. And if only we had had a Piat, which was left on the bridge, we could have knocked it out easily. But in fact, it was there and in position and firing at the rest of the battalion over there.
Shortly, two self-propelled guns rumble over the bridge to the north bank and open fire on the Welsh troops on that side of the river. Bill Owen remembers.
Our Piat failed to fire, and Major Jack Morrison Jones, the battalion second command, was furious and ordered me to find a position on the flank from which we might be able to engage the second SP gun. And I came back to this area with Jack Morrison Jones and pointed out this building to him as a possible firing position. We went in and we found that the only position from which he could fire was by getting onto my shoulders, and he was a big man. He got on my shoulders, fired a couple of magazines of Bren gun towards the SP gun, which was over there, and maintained that he'd knocked out the occupants.
But the Major's claim is premature. Without their anti-tank guns, the Welsh are in a hopeless position. In desperation, the 1st 5th Welsh call for help from the East Blanks, who have remained behind and are about a mile away. The 1st East Blanks gun has just reached the town and is immediately sent forward.
We came from our positions north of the lake and came down to here, where we saw the Welsh were in trouble with SP guns coming from the direction of that bridge. We placed the gun in the position here, and the troops were inside the buildings on the left. The tanks were coming up, firing away at them, and we allowed the tank to come sideways on, roughly where them traffic lights are now, and we fired two rounds. First round stopped the tank, and the second one knocked it out, putting it up into flames. Immediately we'd done that, the crew jumped out of the tank and they were disposed of by the infantrymen. And troops came out of those houses there, they throwing their hats up and cheering like mad and throwing everything about.
The remaining tank sensibly withdraws across the bridge. The crisis on the north bank has passed, but the Welshmen and resistance teams on the south bank are now cut off. Then, about noon, with a tremendous explosion, the Dieser Bridge goes up in the air. It's still a mystery what caused the bridge to explode. Did the Germans somehow succeed in reconnecting the cables, or were the explosive charges, which the Welshmen had left laying on the bridge, hit by a potluck shell? No one knows. The Welshmen are now really cut off. Each hour, more and more German troops are sent to the bridge.
Wir unterstanden damals der Ortskommandantur Gruppe Oberst Ewald. Gleich erhielten wir den Befehl, in einem nahegelegenen Kanalgebiet einer alten Mehlfabrik einzudringen. Uns war nicht bekannt, ob dort noch Engländer noch drin waren oder ob wir sie lediglich besetzen sollten. Nachdem wir unten die Mehlbarrik besetzt hatten und uns überzeugt hatten, dass sich keine feindlichen Kräfte in der Mehlfabrik aufhielten, fanden wir lediglich in einem der oberen Geschosse zwei tote Engländer zwischen diesen Stapeln von Mehlstapeln liegen.
We were down then to about 15 men, and the only way I thought out was to try and get back across the river somehow to join the battalion. So we made our way out of the house into the warehouse next door, where I had an encounter with a German patrol, and where I met one of the Dutch resistance men again. But I'm very glad to say he survived. The Germans didn't kill him. I thought they were going to. And using smoke and grenades, we then made a dash behind me from the warehouse to the riverbank about 200 yards down, just over there, where we were defiladed. We were undercover from fire coming from the Germans from this side.
Nach Ende unserer Inspektion beobachtete aber einer unserer Kameraden, dass im Außenbereich eine Gruppe Engländer offensichtlich wohl das Gebäude verlassen hatten und im Gänsemarsch dem Kanal entlang ihr Glück versucht hatte. Sie ließen dann noch probeweise eigentlich nur noch mal eine Handgranate fallen und dann sind sie offensichtlich für uns unsichtbar unten an der Kanalmauer verschwunden.
But unfortunately, they opened up on us from the other side of the river where we thought our troops were. And we suffered more casualties, were reduced to about 7 men and no ammunition, and were forced to surrender.
The battle for the Dieser Bridge is over. It is, without a doubt, a small but important victory for the German defense. The question remains, what would have happened if the Welsh troops had known of the resistance plans? Would the outcome have been different? After the war, a persistent rumor sprang up that the Allies indeed had had knowledge of the plan. According to this rumor, the RVV group had contacted the British via the other underground organization, the OD. However, from what we now know, there is no substantial evidence to support this story. We do know from the war diary of the Welsh Division that on the very day of the Dieser Bridge battle, October 24th, the field security section of the division, by simply using the telephone, made contact with what they describe as the head of the Dutch resistance movement in 's-Hertogenbosch. But the details of this conversation, or any previous ones, are unknown. We also know that in the weeks preceding the offensive, the OD sent one of their men, Noel Maas, through the lines twice to talk to the officer commanding that same field security section, a Captain Urquhart. But Noel Maas was never informed about the Dieser Bridge plan, so he cannot possibly have passed it on to the British. The conclusion remains. The Dieser Bridge was a missed opportunity, one of those small tragedies typical of the liberation of Holland. The Dieser Bridge is not the only bridge in Den Bosch, but certainly the most important one. Now that this bridge is lost, the Welsh Division will have to try elsewhere. Of the two lone battalions that have reached 's-Hertogenbosch, the 1st East Blanks have dug in on the edge of town, and at daybreak they are confronted with an incredible sight.
1st Battalion East Lancashire Regiment. Across in that direction there was a gap between the a row of houses. And across this gap, as it was just becoming light, we could see the German forces retreating to 's-Hertogenbosch, and they were horse drawn and AFVs. Immediately, all the Bren guns and all the riflemen of the company trained on this gap, and as each vehicle and horse-drawn carriage came along through, so it was engaged with fire, and soon the gap became littered with debris of dead horses, dead Germans, and armoured fighting vehicles. It was just like a shooting gallery with regard to the regiment firing at it.
Battalions in the town. They need tanks to continue the advance. But the terrain between Rosmalen and Den Bosch is far too boggy for tanks.
And so after some discussion, the divisional commander decided that tanks would go into the town moving on top of the railway line. Now this was
all very unorthodox, not at all according to the book. And what is more, it was highly dangerous.
The first troop of tanks that went in was composed of Cromwells and one Firefly, which was a Sherman tank with a large gun, and I was a member of the crew of that Sherman tank. The Sherman was, if somewhat less speedier than the Cromwells and a little bit more ungainly. None of them was suited to running on railway tracks. We were assured that although there was German anti-tank guns on our flank, that smoke would be put down to protect us. By the time we got onto the railway track, it seemed as if we were losing contact with the Cromwells, and we were rather apprehensive, particularly when we saw the smoke that was shielding the guns beginning to thin out. And it seemed we would never make this vast distance which this track appeared to be present to us. And we were shouting at our driver, "For God's sake, put your foot down, Charlie." And Charlie was saying, "I can't put my foot down any harder. I'm standing on the bloody thing."
At 10 o'clock in the morning, the first tanks reach the East Blanks. Shortly after, the Cromwells enter Sertogenbosch itself. But east of Hintem, the Welsh main force is still held up by the German stronghold in the moated farm. The 7th Royal Welsh Fusiliers take over from the 6th.
My task was to capture the moated farmhouse and to carry on the advance into Sertogenbosch. Now, my main problem was to get close enough to the moated farm to assault it without receiving too many casualties before we got there. So I asked for artillery support from a battery of medium guns, and they fired for 10 minutes on the moated farm, and during this time we got as close as we could. Then I wasn't a bit happy about what I saw. It still looked just the same, so I called for another 3 minutes. Whilst we were waiting for this fire support, we saw about 20 Germans running away over the railway line, and somebody in the farm held out a white flag, and then down came the artillery. When that had finished, by the time that had finished, we were getting quite close, and we mused smoke for the final assault. And we captured the farm without any casualties. There were no Germans, but there were three anti-tank guns. We carried straight through on into Hintham, relieving A Company, who had suffered severe casualties the night before.
In Hintham, the battle is over. A Company of the 6th has suffered heavy casualties. The company commander, Major Marsh, a Canlone officer, dies of his wounds. The civilian's ordeal has come to an end.
Het was heel stil. We hoorden nog wel het afschieten van de granaten, maar wij weten niet meer of dat op het park gericht was. Het was een soort niemandsland voor ons geworden. En wij dachten echt dat we toen nog maar alleen in het park waren. En we hoorden vogels, we hoorden kippen. Mijn vader ging af en toe eens even polshoogte nemen buiten. En die zei toen dat het verschrikkelijk eruit zag. He, brand overal en verschrikkelijk alles vernield. En op een gegeven moment komt hij terug. Hij zegt, ik heb een Engelsman gezien, maar ik durfde niet te roepen. Hij stond met de rug naar me toe. Apparatuur op zijn rug. Maar ik was bang dat hij zou schieten door het geluid dat ik zou maken. Dus we hebben iets gezocht waar we buiten iets wits, hè, buiten op de bunker konden zetten. En na een tijd is weer gaan kijken. En toen konden we er eigenlijk allemaal uit. Want er stonden een heel aantal Engelsen op het binnenterrein, wat hier achter de huizen ligt, al met bewoners te praten. Dus die toch ook nog in het park ergens zich verscholen hadden gehouden.
After 2 days of fighting, the 53rd Division has reached the gates of Sertogenbosch. But it will take another 4 days to capture Sertogenbosch. The town, closely built and intersected by numerous water barriers, is ideal for defense and very difficult to capture. The River Aa, the Zedwilmsfahrt Canal, and the River Dummel all pass right through the town. They flow together in the broad Dieser, but the bridge over that river has already been lost. The 12 other bridges in the town become as many vital objects for both sides. The Germans have wired most of them for demolition. Heavy fighting will develop around a number of them, but one crossing, the Ahr Bridge near the water tower, falls into British hands easily. Giel van Marklenburg, a local doctor, was there to see it.
Toen werd ik zo tegen de middag geroepen door een klein jochie. Ik ben namelijk huisarts, ik woon daar op het Hintermarijn. Voor een vrouw die was aan het bevallen daar in het Sint-Josefhuis. Er waren een hele hoop mensen geëvacueerd. En toen ik dan bij die bewuste vrouw aankwam, toen was het eigenlijk helemaal loos alarm. Was helemaal niet nodig geweest. Ze was wel uitgerekend, maar dat duurde nog wel even. Enfin, ik ga naar buiten. Ik kijk heel voorzichtig of ik weer veilig terug kan. En ineens komen daar uit de park daar bij de IJzeren Vrouw, komen daar de Engelsen aan. Nou, je was gewoon ontdaan, ontroerd. Toen je eindelijk die mensen zag komen. Met talkie-walkies en daarachteraan en met mitrailleurs en zo. Enfin, ik heb ze toen kunnen vertellen dat die brug daar ginds op het Hintermarijn over de Zuid-Willemsvaart, dat die nog wel omhoog stond en geladen was, maar dat die nog onbeschadigd was. Ik hoopte eigenlijk dat het misschien hun zou lukken op een of andere manier die brug te nemen. Enfin, er komt ook onder andere een tankwagen aan en alles trekt naar hier toe. Hier daar, bij de kerk van pastoor Barten. Een tankwagen gaat er overheen. Al dat volk dat begint buiten de huizen te komen en dat begint te juichen. En op dat moment vloog die brug de lucht in. Waarschijnlijk omdat de Duitsers toen in de gaten hadden, nou komen ze eraan.
Op de bewuste 24 oktober was ik dus hier weer in het ziekenhuis aan het werk. Toen ik plotseling een telefoontje kreeg van een huisarts, Giel Makkelenberg, die aan de andere kant van de Zuid-Willemsvaart woonde, maar hemelsbreed gemeten, toch maar een halve kilometer hier vandaan. Die vertelde me toen opgewonden dat hij al aan de oranje bitten zat met Engelsen in zijn huis, terwijl we hier nog volop onbewust waren van het feit dat de bevrijding zo kort bij was. Ik was natuurlijk stom verbaasd dat er nog telefonische mogelijkheid was tussen het wat al Engels gebied was en het gebied wat hier nog Duits was.
The West Division has reached the line of the Zedwilmsfahrt Canal, but all four bridges over it are blown. Now begins the prelude to one of the most daring actions in the whole battle for Sertogenbosch. A patrol reports finding a lock at the edge of town. Both bridges over it are destroyed, but the lock gates seem intact. A request goes out for flame-throwing tanks.
We had to do a flaming operation across the river here, across the canal. And I put two of my tanks in the street over to my right, and I kept my own here in this very narrow street coming up here. It was extremely narrow, and one had only a little distance either side. So as soon as we got to this point, I and the other tanks on my right began flaming the houses opposite. And we pumped the flame into those at really the maximum range, which was about 100 meters. And we must have been flaming for 3 or 4 minutes pretty well continuously with just gaps between the shots. And the entire row of houses began to burn. I've often thought subsequently that we burned too much in the course of this war. But there was a great threat to the infantry from German snipers, from the machine gun. And while we were doing this, the bullets were striking the stones here in front as they came from a German machine gun. But the infantry, under cover of our fire and some smoke, started to infiltrate across the sluice gate there.
100 yards to the left of Wilson's tank in a narrow street facing the locks, a company of Royal Welsh Fusiliers stands ready to dash across. Major John Dugdale.
I was commanding A Company of the 7th Battalion, the Royal Welsh Fusiliers. We approached the city of Sertogenbosch from Hintham, behind me. We passed through the 1st Battalion of the East Lancashire Regiment, and I was then told by my commanding officer that the three bridges over the canal in front of me had all been blown. But there was a lock, and it was thought possible that there was a way across the lock. My orders were to see if this was possible, and if it was possible, to rush the lock. We had a troop of crocodiles in support. Strangely enough, after 40 years, there are certain things that you can remember and a great deal more that you forget. And I had forgotten that there was a crocodile immediately on my left. Left-hand platoon advanced here under the city wall. I followed this platoon and we took up a position in the building on the corner where we could see round the corner of the street. Soon after we got into that position, we saw a vehicle coming towards us. This turned out to be the company commander, his Wallis operator and the driver in a captured American Jeep. After he'd got round the corner, we captured him. Some time later, we saw a company of German infantry marching towards us. These were obviously coming to take up a position that had been reconnoitred by the company commander to defend the lock.
During the night, the Royal Engineers build a bailey bridge across the locks. For the soldiers in the tiny bridgehead, the night is dark and full of danger.
I took a night reconnaissance patrol into the canal area here. When we went round the corner, about 15 yards, we came under heavy machine gun fire. I went down straight away on my belly, and the fusilier that was with me ran back round the corner. I felt then very, very lonely. And to my surprise, he crawled alongside me and asked me in Welsh, was I all right? We stayed there for a few minutes again, and we crawled back around the corner and reported back to platoon headquarters.
Now that the division had a foothold in the town, a plan was made to clear the center of the town. The attack would be launched from the area of the Brayley Bridge, which had been constructed over by the locks. And over this bridge, we could send tanks. As a diversion, another attack would be launched a mile upstream in the area of the Deezer Bridge. This would be undertaken by the 6th Royal Welsh Fusiliers from the area of the Citadel.
At that time, along here, there was quite a bit of mist. You couldn't see, for instance, from the back there up to the bridge. So we decided to make the crossing in dead silence as fast as we could. We walked down the road with the boats one behind the other. The first boat got here, and they slid it down this very steep bank into the water. As it touched the water, a Spando opened fire from one of those windows. It killed two or three chaps in the boat and blew a hole right through the bottom of the boat. It was then quite obvious that the mist was not thick enough and they could see us. And that, of course, for the moment, was the end of that effort.
In retrospect, it's questionable whether diversion attack was at all necessary. But judging with hindsight is easy. To the men in the line, it made little difference. Crossing at this point was impossible, almost suicidal. But they obeyed orders and paid a high price.
Nevertheless, although this diversionary attack had failed, the main attack across the Bailey Bridge was in progress. The 1st East Lancashire Regiment was going round the left, along the city walls and moat. and the 1st 5th Welsh along the banks of the South Willems Canal. Finally, the 7th Royal Welsh Fusiliers would move into the heart of the city itself.
For most of the people of Den Bosch, October 25th is the day of liberation.
Ze kwamen van die kant af en we zagen ze hier langs de muur lopen, zeer gespannen, terwijl wij juist natuurlijk enthousiast waren. Hier aan de overkant was een oud gebouw, de sociëteit werd dat genoemd, was afgesloten. En een van de broeders had gelukkig de sleutel, zodat die werd dus toegegooid. En zodat ze dus dat gebouw in konden en waarschijnlijk aan de andere kant de volgende straat in konden. Even later zagen we daar aan de Parklaan de eerste tanks komen. Die gingen naar dat parkje toe. Die tanks werden daar in veelvoud opgesteld. En toen viel ons op de ontspannenheid die die Engelse soldaten hadden. Nadat de vijand weg was, begonnen ze maar rustig hun broodje te smeren. We zagen toen eigenlijk voor het eerst weer witte brood eten.
I was here with my troop of crocodile tanks nearly the whole day. I was actually beyond that tree down there. And throughout the whole of this day there was very heavy shelling here. We closed down the hatches and we were all right inside the tanks, but you could see the infantry around who were constantly taking casualties. And one has this phrase in English, the poor bloody infantry, and I never felt it more than at this time when they were here under the shell and the mortar fire.
Die gewonden die werden bij ons hier binnengebracht in het ziekenhuis en kwamen hier ter operatie. Ging zeer dramatisch toe. Onder het schieten gebeurde dat allemaal. En ja, de enkele pregnante dingen staan me nog altijd goed voor de geest. Onder andere, een van de eerste Engelse soldaten die we behandelden was een man die twee onderbenen stuk geschoten had. We amputeerden hem in zijn bovenbenen. En toen de broeders hem wilden overtillen om op bed te liggen, bleek dat zijn rug een ongelooflijke, afschuwelijke wond vertoonde, zodat het eigenlijk allemaal nutteloos werk geweest was, zou men kunnen zeggen. De man was eigenlijk reddeloos verloren.
In the town center around the market square, the Germans are still present in force. Tension grows by the hour.
Nou, destijds woonde ik in het Tolbrugkwartier, hè? Maar dat noemen ze de Pijp dan, beter gezegd, hè? En ik heb me nog goed herinneren dat de Engelsen binnenkwamen hier, hè? Dat begon dinsdags al, 24 oktober. Toen waren die Duitsers hier met die panzerwagens op en neer om positie te kiezen. En eerst moesten ze doorstaan en toen weer doorstaan. Nou, en toen kreeg je de woensdagmorgen. En dat begon met een beschieting, hè, op die binnenstad. En toen vloog hier het hele gevalletje in brand. Dat was dan het Weermachtsheim, Lohengrim heette dat. Cachettenwinkel, de wijnkelder van de Wijs. Wij waren toen de Wijs in brand stond aan het helpen. Maar we moesten eruit schuiven van de Duitsers. Weg, alles moest van de straat af. Hè. En toen zijn we terechtgekomen bij de Gruiter. En van de Gruiter uit hebben we het hele frutje toen bekeken. En toen was het in de middag. En toen werd het eerst doodstil. Hè. Geurde niks meer. Hè. Natte stilte over de storm. Hè. Nou, en tegen een uur of drie 's middags hoorde ik rikketik, rikketik. Kwamen ze vanaf de Hortestraat van het kazettegebouw af, kwamen die panzerwagens oprollen. Daar zagen we de eerste Tommy's toen, zou ik maar eens zeggen. Die trokken met die panzerwagens, trokken ze mee op. En toen om een uur of vier was het hele frutje bevrijd. Je zag geen Duitser meer, alles was teruggetrokken over de Dommel.
The first troops to reach the market square are from the 1st 5th Welsh.
I put my troops in position around the market square, and I went into a hotel in the center of the market there and made that my headquarters, and had a very pleasant sleep in sheets that night. The civilian population were at that time and on arrival were coming in with bedding, and they spent the night because of the shelling in the vestibule. I hadn't been there very long when one of the ODs arrived. I said he was the head of the ODs and then asked me whether he should bring the ODs out onto the square. And within 10 minutes, The ODs with rifles slung were marching around the square in numbers, which surprised me at the rapidity of from the time he spoke.
It is not only Dutch underground taking part in mopping up operations. Some Dutchmen are regularly attached to the Allied armies. One of them is a native of Sertogenbosch called Piet Cursens. On hearing about the attack on Sertogenbosch, he asks permission to go there.
Hij kende ook Den Bosch en vooral dit deel als geen ander. Hij kwam echter te vroeg en als eerste met nog een Amerikaanse vriend. Heeft de weg toch gevonden via diverse achtertuinen hier. Johannes de Deo, Papenhuls, Karmelitesse. En hierdoor die tuin van meester Loef. En kwam toen te liggen hier op de hoek, Klaarstraat, Hinderstraat, net tegenover zijn ouderlijk huis. En dat was ook de bedoeling. Zijn vader zei op dat moment tegen mijn vader, we zaten in de kelder, kom, we gaan eens boven op zolder polshoogte nemen. Dat kon makkelijk, want we hadden geen dak meer op ons huis, want het was al anderhalve week ervoor afgeschoten. En die twee staan te kijken en wat ziet zijn vader? Twee Amerikanen liggen en herkende daarin zijn zoon Piet. En Piet keek meteen naar boven en zei, papa, ik kom zo en ik heb koffie. Hij heeft een uurtje bij ons in de kelder gezeten, koffie gedronken. En toen zei hij weer, papa, ik ga weer, de bos moet eerst vrij.
But Piet Cursens will not live to see his hometown liberated. The next day, fighting around the Dommel Bridge opposite the station, he's hit in the head. The day after, he dies of his wounds. Three quarters of Sertogenbosch is free. The British have reached the line of the Dommel, the last water barrier. Here, too, the Germans have blown all bridges. But due to a shortage of explosives, they've had to use aircraft bombs as improvised charges.
I was the intelligence officer with the 7th Battalion, the Royal Welsh Fusiliers. And on the night of the 25th, our D Company was occupying this monastery here. And the brigadier wanted to know what the state of the bridges were over the Dommel. So my commanding officer, who's Colonel George Dixon, ordered me to go and look at this bridge here, which was then a wooden bridge. So I said to him, oh, well, thank you very much, Colonel. When do you want me to do that? He said, oh, well, you can do it at midnight. So I dressed myself up in a patrol kit, darkened my face and so on, and had rubber plimsolls on my feet, and took two soldiers with me, Sergeant McKeon and a fusilier. And at midnight, we came out of the monastery right down there and came along the front of the monastery, keeping very close to the wall. And when we reached a spot just over here near that door, I left the sergeant and the fusilier to give me a covering fire if it was necessary. I then crawled across the road, across here and up the bridge. I was really had my heart in my mouth, but when I got to the middle of the bridge, I was very relieved to find that there was indeed a hole in the middle of about 10 feet. And I did hear German voices talking, so I crawled back, picked up my two soldiers, and went very relieved back to the monastery where I told the commanding officer what the form was.
Two other bridges are reported so slightly damaged that they can still be used. The bridge opposite the railway station and the bridge at Wilmsplain roundabout, half a mile to the left of it. The Welsh Division draws up a plan of attack. The 1st 5th Welsh will cross the station bridge at 11 a.m. 1 hour later, the East Lancs will cross the other bridge. The 7th Royal Welsh Fusiliers will stand ready to reinforce any of the two bridgeheads.
On the 26th of October, I was summoned to Battalion HQ, and I was given orders for my company to go and form a bridgehead across the bridge in front of Charlie Company, who were along the canal facing the railway station. When the attack took place in early afternoon,